like ISCO, L&T's, ONGC, key structures, accessible bridges, and structural stability of buildings, etc. Now, I request to you, Dr. Y.D. Patil sir, to start this session.
Okay, thank you, Vaibhav, thank you very much. Okay, first, I would like to thank to Chotubhai Gopalbhai Patel Institute of Technology for giving me opportunity to interact with the participants, particularly on new research areas in structural engineering. This session is being very much useful for PhD candidate, M.Tech candidate, B.Tech students, and the professional field people. Today we will be able to see what are the new areas will be going to come in the structural engineering. So let us start with the session. I'll just share the PPT so that people will be able to see that. Are you able to see my PPT on the screen, please? Yeah, it will take some time. It will take some time. Okay, it will take some time. Wait. So good morning, everybody. Okay, and I hope that you all the people, all the participants or candidate may be safe at home. Okay, and all will be having a very good health. So today we will be going to talk about the emerging research areas in structural engineering. Generally, if you see that the structural engineering, when we talk about the structural engineering, it is being a very vast area. Okay, people used to work in the design section, people used to work in the analysis section, people used to work in the materials, people used to work in the concrete, people used to work in the earthquake engineering, people used to work the effect of seismic forces on the different elements. So it is being a very wide area on which the people wants to work or people are working, particularly in this area, in structural engineering. Let us see a few examples, particularly in structural engineering. Just before 2 days back, we have faced the small earthquake of having 5.1 and 5.3 magnitude of Richter scale, particularly in Bhavnagar, Ahmedabad, and the Kutch area particularly. Okay, and Surat is also having, the people have feel the vibrations up for at least 6 to 6 7s. Okay, and the people are getting afraid of this one. But let us how these structural forces, how the when the earthquake impacts, okay, how this will going to give the devastating effect on the structure, that we will be able to see, okay, through these few photographs are there. Okay, and these are the few photographs are there which will going to show you that how the earthquake will going to impact on the structures, how the flow of force will take place, particularly when the structure is subjected to the seismic forces. Okay, what type of precaution and safety measures we should take when we constructing the earthquake, when we constructing the earthquake resistant structures. Okay, so this is a nice photograph which you will be able to see, that is of frame building, okay, which is being nicely constructed and which will be able to take the different seismic forces and earthquake forces which is subjected to these structures. But if you see that particularly in structure, when we talk about the design, so I have divided this my session into two parts. The first part will going to cover the design aspects, where the second part will going to cover the material aspects. When we talk about the design aspects particularly, so in this case we used to design slabs, beams, columns and foundations. Okay, their methodology, their design, their design patterns, okay, their clauses, everything, they are, we are having a good guidelines given by the Indian Standard Code. Okay, when we talk about the Indian standard code, so IS 456-2000, IS 13920-2016, IS 1893, okay, these and the other many codes are there which we use, which has given a good guidelines particularly for the design of these elements, for the design of the structures. But there are certain elements, okay, where only no design guidelines are given, but only the reinforcement patterns are given to you. For example, okay, if I talk about the beam column junctions, so I know that in the earlier code, particularly that is in IS 13920, 2000, that is 1993, okay, so just a simple reinforcement pattern given for the beam column connections. No other aspects, design aspects are given in the new codal provision, in the old codal provisions. But right now, when we see the new codal provisions, which has come up in 2016, relate, that is IS 13920, okay, so that has been given a certain clause which are related with the beam column junctions, but the design aspects are not given. In our India, particularly if we talk about the connections, okay, we never design the beam column junctions, but we obey the reinforcement pattern which is given in the IS 13920, and according to that we used to go for the reinforcement pattern in the design connections, in the beam column connections. Now when we talk about the beam column connections particularly, okay, so these are the connections which we used, okay, column is one of the important parameter, column, then the surrounding beams which are connecting to that columns, okay. In front of you in my slides, if you see that there are four beams which are connected to the connections, the column and four beams are there. Similarly in my pictures, okay, two beams and the columns are there, as well as the slab pattern is also there. But if you look at to these junctions very carefully, so one thing you will be able to know that, okay, the junctions are being so much of crowded with the steel, so there is a question, how we will be able to pour the concrete in such a connections, okay, because our Indian standard code says that, okay, there should be the minimum spacing, okay, between the two bars, and that will be the what the clause is given in the IS 456, whether the it is a maximum size of aggregate, that is 20 mm, or the largest diameter of bar, whichever is greater, that much amount of space to be gained between the horizontal bars or the vertical bars. Now look at to the junctions very carefully. Now the question is that when there is no space to pour the concrete in such a connections, then how will you going to do the concreting? It's a question. And the things are like that, when we are pouring the concrete in such connections, what we used to do? We used to make the concrete to be flowable. That means what? We increase the slum of the concrete. Hum slum ko badhate hain. Okay, concrete ke andar pani dalke, we increasing the slum of concrete and we are putting to that one. I'm not talking about the self-compacting concrete. Self-compacting concrete is a different things, but when we talk about our normal concrete, then in that case, when I want to pour the concrete in this particular connections, okay, then I have to increase the slum in a such a way that the strength of the concrete should not be reduced. But look at to the sides of the connection, look at to the beams, where the sufficient space is there, where you will be able to pour the concrete very easily. Okay, but when you look at to the junctions, okay, there is a crowding of bars are there. Okay, the bars which are coming from the beam, the bars which are of a column, so all the beams reinforcement and the column reinforcement are to be together at that particular junction, and in that case it is very difficult to pour the concrete. And we said that the court said that the joint shear, the when we are pouring the concrete in the connections, okay, the joint shear are designed, the connections are to be designed to resist the shear. Okay, the connections, the joints are designed to resist the shear. And how this shear is to be resisted? The shear is to be resisted by the strength of the concrete and by the confinement which we are providing in the connections. Confinement means what? Confinement means the column rings or hoops which you are provided in the column. You will be able to see that in the column section, particularly agar aap dekh rahe ho, so there is a rings what we are provided. You can say the rings, you can say the hoops, and these hoops are very, very important in the connections area. Very, very important, because they will be going to confine the reinforcement. They will be going to confine the concrete. Okay, and for confinement of concrete, we need these confinement ring. Okay, but if the statistics wise, if we see that 80% of the joint shear is to be resisted by the concrete, whereas 20% of the shear is to be resisted by the confinement. Now, if the concrete is taking 80% part of the joint shear, then how the strength of the concrete is required? The strength of the concrete should be large enough. It should be able to take the shear, which is transferred by the surrounding beam element, which is transferred by the upper part of the column as well as the lower part of the column. Okay, because connection kya hai? Connection is a small portion of the column. Okay, beam column connection is a portion of the column. Okay, and on that small portion, the surrounding beams are transferring the shear. Okay, on a small portion. Okay, so when the structure is subjected to seismic forces, that time high magnitude of shear generates by the surrounding beams as well as in the columns, and through these columns transfer that shear on a small portion, they transfer that shear on the connections. And in that case, if the joint is not able to design or joint is not able to sustain the shear, okay, then the failure of connection are important from the ductility point of view. And when we design the connections for earthquake and blast loading as per the American concrete code, in that case, okay, ductility and strength, they are the major components which we have seen in the static loading also, in the type 1 also. But what is the specialty of type 2 joint? The specialty of type 2 joint is inelastic range of deformation of a connection and the stress reversal of connection. Stress reversal of connection. For example, if you take a office pin, agar main choti si office pin leta hu, and if I open up that office pin, okay, U pin ko agar main open karta hu, and if I apply the compression and tension up and down and up and down, that is known as stress reversal. That means what? The reinforcement which is subjected to tension, the same bar is subjected to compression also. That means the reversal of stress take place in the reinforcement. Okay, so type 2 connections are to be designed for the stress reversal. Second, it is to be designed for inelastic range of deformation. It is to be designed for the ductility and the strength. Okay, that is very, very important. That is a type 1 and type 2 connections of structures. Now, the next one is that, okay, nowadays, okay, we use limit state of design. Earlier, very earlier, before 2000, we used to go for a working stress method. That time, the factor of safety we used to keep 3. But later on, okay, after 2000, we used limit state method. And when we use the limit state method, there is a restrictions on the size of the elements. There is a restrictions on the size of the elements. That means if you look at to the size of the beam, if you look at to the size of the column, okay, all the dimensions of the beams, columns are to be restricted in the limit state design, and we try to economize, okay, the construction cost, or we try to achieve the economy while you doing the construction, particularly in the limit state method. We used to design for strength as well as we used to design for economy. When there is a restriction on dimensions of the elements, that times, okay, we used to go for the high strength material. And when we are going for a high strength material, okay, so that material is able to take the loads which are subjected, which comes due to seismic forces, okay, the seismic loads which are coming on the elements, that is to be taken by the material, because we are using right now high strength material for the constructions of different elements. These are the few diagrams which will be going to show you the interior joint connections. Okay. Let us move ahead. In our structural engineering, we have drawn the shear force and bending moment diagram for beams and for columns. Okay, we have learned in mechanics of solid or strength of material that shear force and bending moment diagram, we have drawn the shear force and bending moment diagram for different beams, okay, for different frame structures, for columns, but we never draw the shear force diagram and bending moment diagram for the connections. We never ever know about, okay, how much is the moment at the in connection, how much is the shear force in the connections, and how these shear force and bending moment will going to affect on the design of beam column connection. If you look at to these my slides, so you will be having an idea of bending moment diagram, particularly in the connections, okay, and the shear force diagram in the connections, okay, and the crack patterns develop because of the bending moment and shear force in the beam column connections. Okay, these are the forces which are acting on the connections. Normally, agar hum dekhne jaye, okay, so moment and shear, these are the two forces mainly which act on the connections. Okay, moments, maybe clockwise moments or anti-clockwise moments which are acting on the connections. Similarly, the forces which are developed in the reinforcement bar of the beam and in the reinforcement bar of the columns. Okay, so these are very, very important, that how these moments are generated when the connections are subjected to seismic forces. Okay, हमने हमारे during throughout a year of our BTech and MTech, we never ever touch this topic, that is the design of beam column junction. आज तक हमने कभी इस टॉपिक को टच नहीं किया है. We have designed the beam, we have designed the column, we have designed the slab, we have designed the foundations. Almost we have designed all the elements except the beam column connection. And that's why from design point of view, okay, today I have chosen this topic so that I will be able to show you that there is a wide scope of the connections. Okay, there is a wide scope which you can do a lot of research, okay, particularly in the design of connections. Okay, these are the shear cracks which develops in the connections. These are the forces in the connections particularly. Okay, and when we design the connections, so these are the points generally, okay, we need to do. The first, that is the serviceability criteria. Okay, the crack should not occur due to diagonal compression and the joint shear. Okay, that means what? Whatever the shear cracks develop in the beam, that is because of the higher magnitude of shear transferred by the surrounding beams and the parts of the columns. So we use that the connections are to be desired for this desirable. Some criteria are there like serviceability, strength, ductility, and anchorage. Okay, so these are the some desirable criteria which should obey while we designing the connections. So what is a serviceability? Serviceability means what? The crack should not occur due to the diagonal compression and the joint shear. Agar ek simple example main dekhta hu ki ye mera connections hai, okay, and if the building frame is subjected to right sway or the left sway, okay, initially it is squaring portion, okay, or rectangular, but when it is subjected to right and left sway, okay, so that square becomes rhombus, and due to that what happened, one side it is having a tension and other side it is having a compression, okay, so the side which is having a tension, so due to that one there is a diagonal cracks which will be developed in the connection, so we use to avoid the cracks in the connection, that comes under the serviceability. When we talk about the strength, okay, so the strength of the connection should be strong enough than the surrounding elements. If the connection fails, okay, the whole structure comes down. For example, assume that my body is a structure. Okay, so you also know very well that okay, my hands are designed for tension, legs are designed for a compression, neck is designed for a torsion, and my spinal cord is designed for the bending. Okay, so it is a perfect design done by the consultant. Okay, whoever is a consultant, okay, generally we used to call as a god, is our consultant who has designed this body very nicely, very nicely. Okay, so legs are always subjected to compression. Always subjected to compression. Now, if the upper part of my body increases, okay, if weight of my body increases, that load transferred on my legs. Okay, so when it transferred on my legs, so it's having a knee joints. Okay, the complete loads comes down on my knee joint, and if my knee joint is not strong enough, what will going to happen? What will going to happen? Because the load upper part of my body, it comes down, the legs are subjected to compression, okay, and the complete load of my body is to be taken by my knee joint. And if the knee joint is not strong enough, what will happen to my body? My body will going to collapse. Okay, the structure will not be able to stand because the connections are weak, and if the connections are weak, okay, then the body will going to collapse. And you might have seen the person who is heavy weighted, okay, who is having a heavy body weight, okay, won't be able to walk very comfortably because the whole weight is going to come on his knee joint. Okay, so knee joint should be strong enough so that it will be able to take the load of complete structure and the body will not be going to collapse. Okay, so that comes under the strength. So should be more than that in adjacent member. So the connection should be in a such a way that it should be strong enough so that it will not be going to collapse, it will not be going to fail, okay, compared to the surrounding members. It should be ductile, no needed for gravity loads but needed for seismic loads. Okay, I know that in the gravity load, the load moves from top to bottom. But in the seismic load, okay, seismic load we applied horizontally. The structure is remain standing in a vertical position and we apply the horizontal force on the structure. So that time ductility comes into the picture. Okay, so my connection should be strong enough. It should be ductile. Okay. It should be serviceable. Okay, and the last point is that anchorage. Joint should be able to provide proper anchorage to the longitudinal bar of the beams. Okay, or wo kya hai, wo mere next slide mein I will be going to see that. The If you see that this is the external joint, there are generally two beams, three beams are there, one, two, and three. Okay, this is the front portion of the beam column connections. If you see that the horizontal beam where the top bar is subjected to tension and the bottom bar of the beam is subjected to compression. So tension and compression. So if you see that this is nothing but it's a couple. It's a couple, okay? And the moment is to be developed at this particular point, okay? The moment is to be acting at the column, beam column face, okay? And when this type of connection, this is an external joint, okay, where the three beams are to be connected. Agar aap building ke andar, agar aap external face of the building lete ho, external face of the building, if we consider, okay, where the three beams are meeting, okay, so that type of joint is known as the external joint. Okay, within that, the two beams which are in front of them, which are opposite to each other, there will not be any problem because whatever the moments are developed within these two beams, that is to be taken by these two beams and they are nullified with each other, they are effect. But the third beam, which are perpendicular to these two beams, okay, will be subjected to major bending moment, will be subjected to major load, will be subjected to major moment. Now, in that case, when it is subjected to different seismic forces, what will going to happen? Due to these forces, what will happen? You know that the yielding of reinforcement takes place. The yielding of beam reinforcement takes place. Aap yahan is slide mein aap dekh rahe hoge, the things we have written, potential loss of bond in this region, crack patterns and the hooks which we have provided in the connections for the confinement. Okay, and from column face, okay, L shape of bar is moving. Particularly if you see that hook where it has been written, okay, this hook is nothing but from the interior part of the column to this complete length, okay, which is known as a hook, or which is known as a development length. Generally, we used to call it as development length of the bar. That is LD plus 10.5. We will see ahead. Okay. Now, in this case, when this junction subjected to seismic forces, what will happen? You know that the yielding of beam reinforcement takes place. And when this yielding of beam reinforcement take place, okay, so this yielding of reinforcement starts from beam column surface and it will be start penetrating inside the connection, and that's why we have written that potential loss of bond in this region. Potential loss of bond when it is subjected to tension, compression again and again and again, what will going to happen? This beam reinforcement bar is being held up by the concrete. If the bar is moving ups and downs, it's seismic forces when it is going to apply, what will going to happen? You know that the bar will be start loosening up, okay, the bond between the concrete and the reinforcement will start loosening up, okay, and the yielding of reinforcement take place and it will be start penetrating inside the junctions. Okay, and that's why we have written that by providing hooks in the joint core can avoid bond degradation. This is the one. This is very important. Just to listen, then we will go ahead. What will be the new change we would like to do in this design particularly? That adequate development length should be provided at critical region. Okay, and when beam bar is in compression, then horizontal ties are more effective than tail and the end of and that of hooks. Let us, we will see the ahead. This is the diagram which shows you now, okay, this is given in IS 13920 2016, where X is known as anchorage length as per the clause 6.2.5 as per the new codal provision IS 13920 2016. Okay, this type of reinforcement pattern now it has been introduced in the 2016. Earlier code, the pattern is like this. Okay, that is the development length LD plus 10 dB. Okay, that is DB stands for diameter of bar, 10 times diameter of bar, and LD stands for development length, which starts from your X again, which called as a anchorage length in the earlier diagram. So you will be able to see that particularly. So this is the anchorage length, okay, or the development length particularly, LD plus 10 DB in the earlier code, and this will be the in the new code of 2016. Okay, and one more thing which has been added in the 2016, that the minimum depth of the column should be 20 times the largest diameter of beam bar. That means your beam bar diameter is of suppose 25 millimeter, then the depth of the column should be 25 to 20, so that will be equal to 500 millimeter. That is horizontal is the depth of the column. Okay, and one side is 300 mm, which is a compulsory made by the minimum dimensions of the column in this code is 300 by 300 millimeter. Okay, one dimension is to be kept 300 millimeter, and the another dimensions of the column, that is the depth of the column, should be 20 times the largest diameter of beam bar. So if it is a 25 millimeter, then 500 millimeter. Okay, if it is a 16 millimeter diameter of beam bar, then it should be the 16 into 20. That is the minimum depth of the column should be provided for the column. Okay, and when it is to be provided, then this type of, okay, the reinforcement pattern comes in the junctions particularly. Now, what happened exactly? Okay, we want to change slight patterns in this case from the research point of view. We would like to change. And what changes we would like to do, that I will be going to show you in the ahead. But before that, I would like to discuss that this one more clause which has been added in our new code, that the summation of moment of resistance of column should be greater than or equal to 1.4 times the summation of moment of resistance of the beam. That means your moment of resistance of column, okay, should be equal to or greater than 40% more, 40% more than the moment of resistance of the beam. So this clause, we have added one more thing, that is the nominal shear stress of the joint. हमने ये तीन चीज फिर से ऐड की है इसमें इस कोडल प्रोविजन में. When the beam is to be confined on all four faces, that is the internal joint, then the when the beam is confined on all three faces, external joint, and when the beam is confined, okay, by two or by one, then this will becomes in the other cases. Okay, so this will be the clauses what we have added in the new codal provision, though you will be able to see ACI 352R 2002, okay, but in our 2016 IS 13920, okay, we have also added the nominal shear strength of connections, okay, so that we can strengthen the joint as much as possible in the new design code. This is an effective joint area which considers in European code, ACI code, and New Zealand code. So that I will not going to keep much more things. Now, this will be the shear transfer mechanism of beam column connections. Generally, as I talked to you earlier, that the joint shear is to be resisted by 80% is to be resisted by the concrete, and the 20% is to be resisted by the confinement of the rings which you are providing, and that's why, which is very, very important particularly in this connection. Now, what are the new things which you would like to do? The new things which we want to do, that introduction of headed bars. Now, how are you going to introduce? What do you mean by the headed bars? Now, in the earlier sides, you might have seen the L section. L section, which we are providing. And right now in the new code, we are providing 20 times the diameter of beam bar so that the column depth is sufficient, so that the development length is to be sufficient. But in the earlier old code, it is to be provided in the form of L section. Okay, now suppose if I want to provide this hook, if I want to avoid this hook, okay, then we are introducing a headed bar in the beam column connection. Now, what is a headed bar? Okay, so we will see there are two types of mechanical anchorages. The one is friction type of mechanical anchorage, and the next one is the threaded type anchorages. Welded anchorages, friction welding anchorage means what? A reinforcement bar is there. These reinforcement bar, one rectangular or square or circular or oval shape of plate, okay, with certain dimensions to be welded or to be threaded, and it is to be connected with the reinforcement bar. It is to be connected with the reinforcement bar in this fashion. Okay, so the bar is having a head, bearing area, bearing on deformations, and the forces in the bars. Now, this figure is known as headed bar. Okay, this figure is known as headed bar. And instead of providing hook bar in the connections or L shape of bar in the connections, okay, we can replace that bar, okay, by the headed bar. And what is the aim of providing? The aim of providing this headed bar to avoid the conjunction of steel in the beam column connections, to avoid the crowding of steel, particularly in the beam column connection, in a such a way that the concrete can be easily poured in the connections, and the connections to be having a sufficient joint shear strength so that during the earthquake, it will be able to resist the shear in earthquake. Now, in this case, in this headed bar, this plate head, you may be welded, okay, or you may be the threaded. Now, when we talk about the cost of this headed bar, okay, yes, when you are doing something innovative, so initially we have to pay for it. When we want the quality, initially we have to pay for it. But whatever the steel we are saving in the L shape, particularly, okay, so the amount of saving of that steel, as well as the head which we are providing, or the cost which we are incurring in welding or for threading, okay, somewhat how it will be able to manage for a larger volume. Somewhat how it will be able to manage in a larger volume, and that will be from economy point of view, then will be from the cost. Having a certain cost, okay, but it will be adjusted the steel which we are saving in the hook type, in the L shape particularly, okay, but steel, okay, you have to pay something for achieving the quality in the connection. And these headed bars normally used in the columns, in the walls, in the corners, in the foundations also. Now the people are started using its applications. Okay, so at various places, these headed bars are to be used, and it gives you very good results. Now, these headed bars we have used in the beam column junction. My two students which have completed my PhD, particularly in the headed bar, one has completed in the welded, as well as the second has completed in the threaded, and we received a very good results, particularly, okay, for this headed bar. We have seen the reduction. We have seen the reduction in the reinforcement. Okay, and we have also avoided the crowding of bars, particularly at the junctions. And we also get a very good results in the beam column connections by using headed bar in the external joints. These are the failures of headed bars, particularly side face blowout, breakout cone. Okay, these are the few failures which is to be we have observed, particularly in the headed bar. But what is the important thing in this headed bar? And that important thing is anchorage length of the bar in the beam column connection. Anchorage length or the development length of the bar in the beam column connection. If you see that this is the diagram of beam column connection. If you see that, okay, you will be able to see that 132 millimeter length of beam reinforcement which we have been put up over here, just to check, okay, what is the joint shear capacity, particularly when I am providing the headed bar in the connections. Similarly, we have put up another specimen, okay, with the confinement. In this case, you won't be able to see the hoops, particularly in the connections, okay, but in this case, we have also provided the hoops in the connections. We have seen that when we are providing with confinement, how much is the change in the joint shear, okay, and when we are not providing the confinement, okay, how much is the joint shear, okay, how much is the capacity of the joint shear. We have also done one more experiment, okay, for the next specimen, that what is the contribution of anchorage length, what is the contribution of head, okay, because headed bar is having a two parts. One is a head, maybe square, rectangular, circular, oval shape, okay? So this is another good area where the student, where the candidate can do the research, okay? By providing different shapes of headed bar, okay? Maybe through welding or maybe through threading, okay? So these are the two parts. One is a head, another is a development length or the anchorage length. Okay, and in that case, we have individually determined or find out the contribution of head and the contribution of a embankment length or contribution of a anchorage length. So what we have done, we have put the PVC sheeting, okay, PVC pipe in the reinforcement to know the contribution of a head. To know the contribution of a head only, and we have calculated the contribution of head, we have calculated the contribution of anchorage length, and then later on we have combined what is the effect of anchorage length, what is the effect of head, and what is the combined effect of these two, and how the joint shear capacity of the joint increases, how the performance of joint will see well by providing the headed bars in that connections. Okay, so this is the general behavior of connections, so I will not be going much more deep into that one. Okay, so this will be related with the design thing, design parameters, okay, where the candidate can do the lot of research in these particular areas by changing the embankment lane, by changing the anchorage lane, by changing the development lane, by changing the diameter, by changing the shape of the head, by changing the different bearing area of the head. So there is a lot of scope of doing the research, okay, in the design area of a beam column connections. Okay, now the second I will be going to talk about the materials. Okay, my few students are working particularly in polyethylene terephthalate, pani ki bottle, plastic ki pani ki bottle. Okay, we know very well that we use and we just throwing it. Hum pani ki bottle use karte hain, pani peene ke baad usko fek dete hain. So it is a one type of waste we are generating on the other end, okay, and our government of India is also putting a lot of emphasis on reducing the use of plastic, okay, reducing the use of plastics. So what we are doing from the material point of view, okay, in our structural engineering, Okay, the water bottle is made up of polyethylene terephthalate. Okay, polyethylene terephthalate. So what we people have done, you know that, okay, this polyethylene terephthalate, okay, we have used different type of chemicals, ethylene glycol, and there are number of glycols are there, and we have used this polyethylene terephthalate material, okay, particularly for doing the research in structural area. Okay, many people, what they are doing, you know that many people use that polyethylene bottle directly, they are cutting up the bottle, making into a number of pieces in the different shapes, okay, and that pieces they are using in the concrete in place of replacing of cement or fine aggregate or coarse aggregate. So this is one of the area where the people are working, but lots of people have used in this particular area, and in this nothing is new in doing this thing only, because generally what we used to do, just cutting the bottle, making into different shape particle, and that we are putting into a concrete and doing, and we are measuring the mechanical properties as well as the fresh properties of the concrete. There is nothing new that has been over at that particular place. Well, then what is the new thing which you can be used by using these plastics? Okay. Okay, so on one side, we are going to reduce the plastic, we are going to save our environment. On the other side, that plastics we will be going to use in concrete, and we can make it to be useful. We are going to change the phase of that polyethylene terephthalate or the plastics. We know that Surat city is famous for diamond, Surat city is famous for bridge, okay, and Surat city is famous for synthetic also, okay. So when we talk about the synthetic, okay, so every day, okay, every day we are producing lot of polypropylene and lot of polyester, which act as a waste material particularly. Okay, if you see on our waste plant, okay, which is developed by Surat Municipal Corporation, okay, so the maximum waste we used to come over there is polyester and polypropylene. How to make use of this polyester and polypropylene so that we can reduce the use of this waste, and that has to be used in somewhere else which can be used, okay, and we can make it possible. But we have to see the care also that by using this one, there should not be pollution in the atmosphere. Otherwise, it will be going to happen that on one side we are reducing the waste, on other side we are making the pollutions by burning this plastics material or by putting the toxic gases into atmosphere. So this should not be there. We can use this paint or material in a such a way that, okay, shredding, mechanical shredding is one of the parameters, but now that has been saturated, but the other parameters are there which has been open up the new areas, which have opened up the new doors, and that is what, by making resins from these paste, from polypropylene, from polyester, and use of these resins as a binder, okay, in the concrete. Okay, right now we used to call as a polymer concrete. Okay, polymer concrete generally we used for strengthening of a structure, we use for the retrofitting of the structures. Okay, now in this case, the plate flakes are there. Okay, these plate flakes you can be melted through a certain temperature, that is, it depends from 80 degrees centigrade to 150 degrees centigrade by using a small instrument, and this is a very small instrument which will be available in our chemistry lab also. It is not being much more costly, okay, and by using different types of glycolysis method, by different types of MEKPO chemicals, okay, in such a way that ki the resins which we have been prepared at a certain temperature by using these polyethylene terephthalate flakes which we received from the plastic bottle, okay, and those flex material get melted at particular temperature, at different temperature, we are making that resin, and that resins we are using some filler material like cement, sand, and some more materials which we can use. We can prepare the polymer concrete, okay, and we can use that polymer concrete for strengthening or retrofitting of the structures. We have also observed that particularly when we are making this resin, okay, we have to go through many processes. Sometimes we are getting results, sometimes we are not getting results. But one thing which I have been observed, when we are getting some positive results, तो advantage के साथ disadvantage होते हैं और disadvantage के साथ advantage होती ही है. Okay, like that it is to be getting together. Okay, for example, when I'm going to put the full focus or concentration on my mechanical properties, like a compressive strength of the concrete or the tensile strength of the concrete or flexural strength of the concrete, okay, I'm putting my whole focus on mechanical properties. Okay, so what I have been observed that the initial setting time is of 30 minutes. But while I'm using this paint material with some different chemicals, it is going to use to set within the 5 minutes. Okay, so what is it? Is advantageous or disadvantageous? On the other side, if you see that, okay, so hum ye kahenge ki nahi ye to disadvantageous hai because the initial setting time of cement or concrete is of 30 minutes. But what is the advantageous which I have been seeing? I have been seeing that when it is going to set for 5 minutes, so I can use that type of concrete in underwater construction. Okay, in underwater construction. Okay, or where the foundations of the building or the foundation of the structures where there is a continuous evolving of water is coming. Okay, where I need a concrete which will going to set within the few seconds. So in that place, I will be going to use such a type of concrete where it will be going to set within a few minutes. So it is advantageous for that purpose. Okay, don't look at on the other side. If I'm having a disadvantage in one thing, but I'm having advantage on the other parameter also. Okay, but generally what we happen, we used to focus only on one parameter. We never see, we never explore the other parameters, which is surrounding of that parameters, which are connected to that parameters. Okay, so we have to keep our eyes to be open. We have to keep our eyes to be open in a such a way that if I'm not able to achieve my aim, so what I'm able to achieve on the other side? That is very important. In my research, don't think that okay, I'm not getting the results, I have got the negative results. No, if you got the negative results, that means there is something positive on the other side. So you keep change of your vision. Aap apna vision change karo ki yahan pe negative hai to kahin to bhi positive hai. कहीं तो भी पॉजिटिव है. ओपन योर आईज, ओपन योर थर्ड आईज इन दैट पर्टिकुलर डायरेक्शंस. ओके, इन दैट पर्टिकुलर डायरेक्शन एंड फाइंड आउट व्हाट इज अ पॉजिटिव थिंग आई एम गेटिंग पर्टिकुलरली फ्रॉम दिस रीजन व्हिच इज वेरी 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 इंपॉर्टेंट व्हिच इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इन द नेक्स्ट. सो नाउ वी आर यूजिंग पॉलीप्रोपेट मटीरियल पर्टिकुलरली in the development of polymer concrete, and that polymer concrete we are using for strengthening and retrofitting with a very low cost, with a very low cost. So we are doing work particularly on this one, okay, and sooner we will be going to put the positive axis, positive result for such a by using this one. But particularly when we talk about the polypropylene and polyester, okay, we are working in that directions. Still, we have not achieved the results what we want. But I know that we are going to get a good results, particularly when we will be going to use polymer and polyester, okay, with the different feelers, okay, which will be advantageous for making a new material. These are the few photographs which will show you that how the flakes are to be converted into particles and how the particles are to be get converted into semi-solid, and we are getting the resins. Okay, and one more thing which I would like to highlight you in this case, that when you are producing the resin and when you are using that unsaturated resin or saturated resin, okay, with different chemicals, with different fillers, we will be able to achieve the mechanical properties what we need. What we need, I need a concrete which is having a highest wear and tear property. Yes, I will be able to produce. I will be going to use the chemicals in a such a way that with the resins that I'm able to achieve the concrete which is having a higher wear and tear resistance. Higher wear and tear resistance. If I need a concrete which is having a higher toughness, okay, we're having a higher energy absorption, having a higher flexural strength. Let us take the example of a rigid pavement. Let us take the example of a rigid pavement, cement concrete ke road. Okay, cement concrete ke road hum flexural ke liye design karte hain. Flexural ke liye design karte hain. And if you want to achieve the high strength, high flexural strength value, then in that case, we will be able to achieve the high flexural strength by using polymer in the concrete, by using the polymer in the concrete. So any type of mechanical properties, whether it is hardness, toughness, wear and tear resistance, if you need a ductile concrete, you will be able to produce the ductile concrete from the different type of resins. So this is another a new area where the candidate should go, should explore and do the research, particularly in the structural engineering. These are the few results, okay, which we have got, okay, which we achieved, and we are moving step by step ahead where the student can explore much more, okay, and will be having a very good areas have been opened up, particularly in the polymer concrete, okay, by using PET, by using polyester, by using polypropylene. So we are slowly moving ahead. Now, one more thing which we have opened up the area, the students, my students have worked particularly on cold bonded lightweight aggregates made up of activators. Okay, this is another a good thing where you can do a lot of research particularly. Okay, this is a fly ash. When we used to take a name of fly ash, initially we used to as a byproduct. Okay, ki bhai fly ash production bahut hai, lekin aaj ke din mein fly ash milna, it is a very difficult, because all the complete fly ash is to be taken by the cement factories for making the cement, okay. So fly ash, then the day by day, if you see that our natural resources are getting depleting very fast. Okay, there is a lot of exploitations of our natural resources, like fine aggregates, like a coarse aggregates. Okay, lot of quarries are okay vanishing day by day. Okay, now in such a situations, what should I do so that I will be able to put a by using byproducts which I'm getting from the industry, and using that byproducts, I will be able to make artificial fine aggregates, artificial coarse aggregate, and use of that artificial coarse aggregate or artificial fine aggregates into my concrete. Okay, and I will be able to make a good quality of concrete for my constructions. So one of my students have worked on the lightweight aggregate. He has developed a new instrument for making this aggregate, okay, for making these pellets, and he has used different chemicals for making of these aggregates. Okay, he has used different size of aggregates, he has prepared, he has find out its all mechanical properties, his fresh properties, okay, and he has got very good results by using these aggregates, and he has prepared a very good quality of concrete through these aggregates. Okay, so you will be able to see these are the known as the pellets. This is the grinding, this is the machines where the pellet has been prepared with the different percentage of fly ash, with the different percentage of chemicals, okay, and the crushing strength of the these pellets or these aggregates that we have been measured. And once we assure that, okay, ki this can be used in our concrete having good properties of this aggregate, then later on we use these aggregates in the concrete, we achieved a very good strength, okay, and right now we are using these aggregates in the concretes and we are producing it on sites also. Okay, we are moving ahead. It's a lightweight aggregate, so lightweight concrete you will be able to get. But if you want to go ahead of this one, so by adding some other fillers, okay, you can make a concrete which is having a high strength, which is having a high strength. So there are many areas which has been opened up in new in a structural engineering, particularly in civil engineering, where the candidate can work, okay, where the candidate can explore, okay, whether it belongs to BTech, MTech or PhD or a professional fields, okay, so you can move ahead a step by step. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, I would like to ask to Dr. Chinmay Desai, if is there any questions from the audience, so it has been most welcome. Okay. Chinmay Desai, please.
Yeah, yeah. Hello, sir. Hello. How are you? It was really interesting. Hello. One. Can you listen me?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Even though I'm a mechanical engineer, I enjoyed a lot.
Yeah, I'm listening.
Even though I am a mechanical engineer,
thank you, sir. Thank you. So nice of you. thank you.
Very interesting topic.
Okay, basically the hidden part is a combination of mechanical and civil, okay?
Yeah,
which we have developed right now.
Correct.
Yeah. Oh, now any question from the audience, most welcome.
Yeah, Vaibhav was hoping the question, please.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you so much
for
giving the excellent lecture.
Yeah, thank you.
Students learn a lot and benefit from your
one-hour
session. And thank you so much, sir.
Yeah. But any questions from the audience which you have received or people would like to ask?
One question is there, sir.
Okay. So I would like to thank to Dr. Chinmay Desai.
Sir, there is one question. Vaibhav is reading that question, please.
Yes, sir. Sir, one question is there.
Please.
Is there any single material which can be used to increase both compressive strength and tensile strength? Is there any single material which can be used?
Okay. Material is related with the concrete because, okay, steel is strong in compression as well as tension is there. Okay. But if you see the particularly the polymer concrete, okay, which will be having particularly, which will be ductile also, okay, and will be having a good strength also, okay, because right now the polymer concrete we are using for strengthening and retrofitting of structures. So within a very short period, we are getting a very high strength concrete, we are getting a high strength of that element, okay, as well as it is also act as a ductile also. Okay, so it is a very good, which very good results what we have been received, particularly in polymer concrete. Okay, what we have used particularly in PET, okay, polyethylene terephthalate. Okay, when we are using with MEPQ or when we are using with some other filler material, so we are getting a very good results particularly in this case.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes. Okay, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Vaibhav.
Yes.
And I would like to thank Dr. Chinmay Desai, that is Chotubhai Gopalbhai Patel Institute of Technology, who has I'm also thankful to the management who has given me opportunity to interact with the people, to interact with the participants. Okay. Thank you once again for management. Okay. And thank you.
I would like to thank Dr. Chinmay.
Okay, yes, Vaibhav.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I would like to thank Dr. Chinmay Desai, sir. Chotubhai Gopal Bhai Patel Institute of Technology under the roof of Uka Tharsade University, NAC accredited with a good rank. The view of education and training future professionals to lead in a today competitive environment and to meet the needs of globalization and industrial by providing the dynamic and conductive learning environment. CGPIT offers a BTEC programs in a discipline like electronics and communication, electrical, civil, computer, information technology, mechanical, automobile and chemical engineering. CGPIT also offers a MTech programs in a discipline like electronics and communication, civil, computer, information technology and mechanical engineering, PEG programs, and also carried out this CGPIT in a discipline like electronics and communication. Uka Tharsadia University have a 550 plus staff, 10,000 plus students, and different collaborations with the NITs and industries, and also fastest growing university, eco-friendly infrastructures, and a job fair and campus placement. Thank you so much.